It's a pleasure to welcome all of you for the FM lecture series. This is the first lecture of the Faculty of Management for this academic year, and we wanted to start it with something which is more talking about what we do, and that is why we thought that the title of Managing Cities would be something which is very much interesting with what all is happening in our cities these days, so much of changes and transitions that we are looking at our cities. Then we thought that if our municipal commissioner can come and talk to all of us and tell us how challenging and interesting a job this is, that would be icing over the cake. Thank you, sir, for accepting our invitation and coming over here and talking to our students. I would like to invite our dean, Professor Manvita Baradi, to introduce the speaker to the audience.
Thank you, Mercy. Thanks, sir, for coming, and we're really grateful that you could make time today. Faculty members, Bimal Bhai, Chetan Bhai, all our students, Commissioner sir, and many of our friends from the architecture and planning community. You can see the house is so full. You can understand how popular you have been, sir.
So, happy that sir is here. I'll introduce him formally to the audience. Shri Vijay Nehra is a Municipal Commissioner of Ahmedabad. He has recently completed his master's degree at Goldman School of Public Policy at the University of California, Berkeley. Better, thank you.
He's also done his post-graduation in IIT Mumbai before he joined the administrative services. He's been a 2001 batch IAS officer. In past, he has held positions of Municipal Commissioner of Rajkot, and Mr. Paresh Vyas, who is our faculty member at Faculty of Management, has been the Deputy Commissioner, so they know each other very well, and we are very happy that we could make this happen, sir. He has been awarded twice the Best Collector's Award, and specifically for Baroda, Vadodara. The award comes in the wake of his proactive role during 2009-2008 for propagating and bringing forth nearly 12,000 senior citizens under Indira Gandhi National Old Age Pension Scheme. Mr. Nehra has created sort of history by securing first place in the country in implementation of the scheme. He was also awarded and streamlining the core revenue administration and speedy, effective system for land records. Sir, we're happy to have you and talk to us. Thank you, sir.
Good evening. A very good evening to all of you. This happens to be my first public engagement or public talk after I joined as Ahmedabad Municipal Commissioner about 45 days back. I am excited about it because CEPT University is a prestigious institution, and anybody working in Ahmedabad would look forward to speaking at a place where the faculty and students are present. So I'm indeed excited about the talk this evening, but at the same time I'm slightly intimidated as well. Large number of youngsters, brilliant minds, and who managed to turn up sharp at 6:30. So we have been able to start at 6:30, and I hope that we'll be able to finish at 7:30. But I do not think that I have the capacity to speak for 1 hour. Public speaking is not something that we are normally used to. And to make things worse, or probably better from your perspective, I do not have a PowerPoint presentation. managing Indian cities. I don't know if I'll be doing too much of self-deprecation, but normally you won't expect a government servant to be talking about managing Indian cities. You would rather want them to be talking about mismanaging Indian cities. There's a lot that happens which we are not happy. But I would like to share, I think I'll be speaking for 5, 10, max 15 minutes, and then I look forward to engaging with you, because while coming here, I have been looking forward to this experience to be able to go back with some learning points, with some good ideas, with some intelligent interventions. I think the kind of range of work that happens in the municipal corporation, if some of you were to think about it, it's mind-boggling. With limited resources, in terms of financial resources, the ability to raise resources is also limited. We do not have too much of independence in being able to levy new taxes or increase existing tax structures. But the kind of services that the corporation is expected to deliver, literally everything that happens in the city, which a citizen has to do with, starting from your water supply, in a city of 70 lakh population, if we perform 99% in water supply, it's going to lead to a riot. Or drainage, stormwater, street lighting systems, roads, bridges, parks, gardens, early childhood education, preschool education, primary education, secondary education, primary health centers, secondary health centers, tertiary hospitals, super specialty hospitals, fire brigade, town planning, building permissions, sports, swimming pool, you name it, and we have to handle all of it. So everything that you are having to are being concerned with, it's being done by the local body. But all the taxes that you are paying is probably not coming to the local body. Most of it is going somewhere else. So municipal corporations are normally starved of funds. We have serious HR issues. So I have a workforce of 25,000 people. The day I joined, one of the first questions that I asked in my review meetings, that how many sanitation workers do we have? And I was told 13,000 of them. And then I said, why is the city so dirty? I was told most of them do not turn up for work. In the morning, attendance is less than 60%. In the evening, afternoon session, attendance is less than 40%. Then I did ask, why don't we insist on attendance? There is technology available, why don't we go for biometric attendance systems? And I was told it was attempted in the past, in 2014, the machines were broken. Any officers who try to enforce attendance, they are beaten up. And the unions will go on a strike if I were to insist on attendance. 3 to 4 days in the first week, every single meeting I was trying to somehow motivate my subordinate supervisory staff to insist on attendance. I literally gave up and I asked them only one thing. Okay, if they do not come and work, it's fine, but at least insist that they have to come and mark their attendance. They may not be used to working for 10, 15 years, so probably they may not be able to physically work. At least ensure that they come and mark their attendance twice a day in the morning and evening, which they are supposed to do. And if they do not come up, mark them absent and start deducting their pay. It should happen anywhere. And it was less than 48 hours that I got a strike call that the Safai Kamdars, the sanitation workers, will be going on a strike. So this is the kind of challenging environment. I'm just trying to narrate this only with a view to share how challenging HR issues can be. How we tackled it, it's another story. During the interaction, if anyone of you is interested, we'll share in greater detail about that. Now just think about sanitation. HR issue is one thing. We have limitations on financial resources. I'm being recorded.
Yes.
Okay, that's okay. But just think of it, in a city of, even if the 13,000 workers were to start working like the most sincere workers on this planet, they start working at 7 in the morning and they clean up the city by 10. So I request all of you to, from tomorrow, try to observe how the city looks between 8, 9 and 10 in the morning and how it looks later in the evening. Because we have 13,000 people cleaning up the city. And after that, there are lakhs of citizens who wage a war against the city. Even if 90% of our citizens, and I am being hugely optimistic, even if 90% of our citizens were to start behaving like you people do and become the Adarsh Nagrik, they do not throw anything on the roads, but we still have 10%, and at 10% it still comes to 6 to 7 lakh people. So if 6 to 7 lakh people wage a war against the city and the sanitation workers, it's anybody's guess as to who wins that war. So our city essentially spends more than 300 crore. We as citizens spend more than 300 crores annually out of our pockets to keep the city clean for 2 to 3 hours. And after that, it goes back to where it was. So now you try to understand the entire thing, that it's not essentially only a planning challenge or a system issue or an HR issue or a budgeting issue, but there is a serious element of citizen behavior involved. And then, of course, I mean, I have a lot of people I interact with, and we should launch IEC on a large scale. We should do behavioral change communication, and we should do awareness generation. I mean, who in this country has not personally heard the Honorable Prime Minister talking n number of times about this issue? Who has not been made aware about this? So I think every single citizen in this country, at least now, understands or has heard about the importance of sanitation and not littering, etc. So there is a limit to which you can do awareness generation. So those are big challenges. So now we have decided that there has to be another mode of behavioral change communication. And at the end of the day, some amount of enforcement is necessary. Rule of law is something that we cannot do without. The basic respect for laws has to be there. So we have now initiated a drive in which we are penalizing citizens in a big way. Last 1 month, we have collected fines in excess of 1 crore rupees. So this is the level at which we have to go to address a single issue. So HR issue, awareness generation, enforcement. Or for that matter, you can, as simple as an issue, I spent some time, as was narrated, last 1 year I was in US. I was just wondering how easy it would be to run a city like San Francisco or even New York. It would not be even 10% of the difficulty that we encounter. Simple thing like immunization. The top scientists have decided that measles, rubella, there's a disease incidence, a vaccine has been developed, a lot of research has gone into it. Society, scientists, everybody, they have invested a lot. And now we have created a vaccination program. In any developed country, all you have to do is create vaccination centers and create a supply chain. What are we having to do here? Daily, I am having to spend 2 hours only in trying to convince people that please don't let your children die. And there are large sections of population which refuse to be immunized. So just consider, I mean, it's one part of your job to create a health center, create a vaccination system, provide for vaccinators and a supply chain management. That part is reasonable, it's doable. But what happens if large sections of the population just refuse to cooperate? Or for example, the issue of vector-borne diseases. You would be reading in the newspapers, and especially the vernacular press would report that the corporation is not doing anything and there are large cases of malaria. If certain sections of citizens decide to do mosquito breeding in their houses, how can possibly any municipal authority reach into every single house and search every single vessel and every single flower pot and every single refrigerator or the trays, etc. Is it possible? Is it doable? Is it even a system that can work? So those are the kind of challenges. And whatever you think, there's another set of challenges. The issue of, for example, as simple as a thing as cave-ins. We have been seeing a lot of cave-ins. Every monsoon, every year we have 50, 60, 80, 100 road cave-ins. So this time we decided to go with a root cause analysis, trying to analyze every single cave-in. Why is it happening? Whether it's a stormwater line, sewage line, what's the age of the line, whether it was rehabilitated or not, whether it was desilted or not, what is the diameter of the line, and trying to kind of do a scientific analytical approach, root cause analysis. And then we realized that several lines are 40 years old. They have not been maintained. Now all of a sudden we realize that in the absence of proper maintenance, we are having lines are breaking and the roads are caving in. So while managing cities, as you understand, there are multiple issues. There are issues of financial resources, there are manpower issues, and then of course there is an overarching issue. There's also a police commissioner in the city, which you are all aware. But the police commissioners get to work in an independent environment. We have to work the municipal corporation is a political entity. We have to work along with a political body. To be able to align interests and to be able to successfully manage divergence of interests, that can be a big challenge. So that is the challenges we face in managing Indian cities. Nonetheless, I personally am really pleasantly surprised with the kind of response we have been able to elicit from citizens in general and the kind of progress that we have been able to make in a small time. Going forward, the challenges would be to be able to sustain some of the successes that we have made. There is a talk of smart city. But we need to understand what essentially is a smart city. At times, people within our system get carried away. They think that more computers and more fiber and more cameras and this is a smart city. But I've been trying to explain to them that this is not a smart city. A smart city is a city in which it's properly planned, where it's the normal services that we provide, the provision of those services can be more efficient, can be more effective, and citizens can be more satisfied in water supply, in solid waste management. So how do we use technology or better managerial systems to improve the delivery of existing systems? That's one part of moving towards a smart city. More importantly, a smart city is one which is having a sustainable development. We are not messing up our natural resources. We are taking care of the environment. We are taking care of air quality. We have the best city in terms of infrastructure, but if the air that we are breathing, that air quality is not good, it cannot be called a smart city. We cannot have a smart city if people cannot walk on its streets. It won't be a smart city if we focus too much on vehicles and we make a city for cars and not for people. So a smart city would be one which takes care of the present development needs without compromising the future generations' resources and their access to the same resources. A smart city would be one in which there is a tangible improvement in the equity issues. On the one hand, we have prosperity, and on the other hand, we have people living on the roads, not being able to feed themselves. It cannot be called a smart city. A smart city would be one which takes care of all sections of the society. Every single citizen should feel involved, should feel take pride in being a citizen, resident of that city. So we are trying to realign some of those priorities in the smart city project. Mobility is another issue. Going forward, probably in the last few decades in India, the biggest challenges were related to poverty, were related to roti kapda makan issues. As a country, we have made significant progress on those issues. But the issues of today and probably tomorrow are going to be different. Traffic congestion, air quality, mobility, these are going to be some of the biggest challenges in the near future. How do we address them? Our public transport systems, presently, are they good enough to be able to attract the car owners? Because we have to have our public transport of such a good quality that we are able to attract the car owning, vehicle owning class on the public transport. So we are taking some specific steps on that, moving towards electric mobility. We have very ambitious plans in Ahmedabad to be the leader in India in terms of eco-mobility. So we are planning to induct electric air-conditioned buses across the fleet in AMTS as well as the bus rapid transit system. But every single thing that we do, the kind of challenges that we encounter is at times huge. Even as simple as a thing as being able to introduce a smart card in the BRTS system. So we have to fight with people who will just oppose for the sake of opposition. We have to fight with sometimes work extra to be able to educate some of the print and electronic media people. And then in every single thing that we'll do, somebody is always running to the courts. So for that person, it's an issue. At times they file PILs, which are not public interest litigations, but at times they are publicity interest litigations. So they will get their publicity. Now increasingly the courts are aware of this issue. Recently when we introduced this card, somebody went to the court saying that you can't make it compulsory. We told the court, okay, we have no intention of making it compulsory, but now we are making it so attractive that people will try to take it. Next day the guy again goes and makes another civil application, saying that now they are making it so attractive that everybody will buy it. So then it is becoming compulsory, no? So we are having serious issues on fighting at multiple fronts. I was just reviewing in the last 2 hours one of the issues on housing. 10 years back, when there would be any slums on a government piece of land, people would, authorities would just go and remove them without any talk of any rehabilitation, etc. Now the present policy provides for a rehabilitation free of cost, despite the fact that it's an illegal encroachment. It also provides for a transit accommodation till the time of the construction. We still are having issues. Because there are some antisocial elements will be there who would have multiple units rented out, and they will instigate the poor people. So every single thing that we do, the planning and implementation of the scheme is one part, but to be able to take care of the externalities of the entire implementation, that's a big challenge for us. Nonetheless, it's not a depressing story, let me tell you, because since the topic is managing cities, I'm just trying to tell you some of, give you a flavor of some of the challenges that we face, some of the things that we have to do. On the positive side, as you have seen, our traffic situation in the city is better. For the first time, people are willing to pay for parking in this city where people have never paid for parking. Within a span of less than 7 days, we were able to identify 74 huge land parcels across the city, which we have designated on a WAF footing as pay and parking plots. We have been able to use pricing mechanisms as policy incentives to alter citizen behavior. We have been able to remove more than 30,000 encroachments. And of course, then there are 1 lakh cattle on the road, I just forgot. What do you do? I mean, you build a road of 500 crores, and the day it is inaugurated, the next day you will see 100 lari gallas on that, 500 cattle on that and people throwing garbage on that. And then vehicles being parked haphazardly. तो हम लोग रोड बनाते हैं और उसके ऊपर फिर जानवर आ जाता है, लारी गल्ला आ जाता है, गाड़ियाँ इधर उधर से आ जाएंगी एंड पीपल विल जस्ट थ्रो गार्बेज ऑन द रोड्स. सो वी कैन नॉट हैव अ रियल मॉडर्न डेवलप्ड सिटी अंटिल अनलेस वी टेक केयर ऑफ ऑल दीज इश्यूज एंड एवरीथिंग दैट वी डू देर आर सेंटिमेंट्स एंड इमोशंस अटैच्ड विद एवरीथिंग. फॉर एग्जाम्पल व्हेन आई रिमूव द And I'm sure there'll be a lot of supporters of what I'm trying to say. On the law garden, Khau Gali. I can expect some supporters of the law garden, Khau Gali in this particular crowd. But we are aware of all sentiments. The kind of feedback channels that we have been able to establish through various channels and mechanisms. So we are getting good feedback from citizens. Our policies are flexible. We are taking care of every single sentiment that is being expressed in the city. But what do I say to a person who says that this person has illegally occupied this land parcel? It belongs to the public. He has never been allotted this in any transparent manner. This person has never paid a penny to the public exchequer. And this person has, over a period of time, occupied 1, 2, and up to 10 slots. And this person has now started renting out these 10 slots and is minting money out of it. So yesterday the association people came to me because they had been trying to establish contact, and finally I gave some time to them and I said, you get me a list of the poor people who were there. So they came with a list of 100 people and I spent half an hour with them and I could tell them that this 10 names are the same. These 5 names are the same. And these are crorepatis. Who have 500 hotels elsewhere. So why can't they go some other place and find a place for themselves? Just as every single citizen of this country is doing. As far as the poor people are concerned, I'll accommodate them all. And if your concern is to come up with a nice food street, we will do in a manner which is consistent with the legal provisions, which has got transparency, which is well planned, and where hygiene and sanitation are taken care of. So you will soon see that we take care of all these issues. But it's not an issue about 100 people. You read about the 100 people, you worried about the 100 people, but there are actually more than 80,000 people in this city, all of whom are doing some livelihood, gaining some livelihood through hawking or vending. It's an unsurmountable challenge in every single way. No city in India has attempted to organize this. But we have taken up this challenge and we plan that within the next 1 or 2 months, we will be able to survey, enlist, verify all of these people, give identity cards to all of them, allocate places of business to all of them, and then ensure that wherever they are operating, they do it in a neat, clean, and hygienic manner. The cattle owners on Janmashtami, you must have read, so they talk about tradition. So when the Khau Gali people told me about tradition, I said, your tradition is 20 years, 30 years, or 40 years old. The cattle owner's tradition is more than 100 years old. They have been living here and they are used to putting their cattle at a particular place. The city has subsequently developed at the same place where their cattle have been used to. But we cannot permit that. Change is inevitable. We have to learn to accept the change. And a lot of representation was made that since 1984, there has been a parampara to release all the cows on Janmashtami. I said, I don't understand such paramparas because it doesn't serve the interest of the animal. So, essentially for the last 1 month, whenever we were impounding, they were not coming and getting their cattle released because they would have to pay fine. And they were waiting for this particular auspicious day when they will all be released for free. So I said, you don't take care of these animals in any case. As long as you can milch them, you are taking care of them. But the day they stop giving you milk, you just let them on the roads, let them eat plastic and garbage, and they collide with the traffic, lead to injuries to people and themselves. We are the biggest Gorakshaks. We take care of 2,000 cows at any given day. We feed them properly. So we were not really worried about that, and we withheld, we withstood our ground, and we discontinued that whatever parampara was. But now it's a gigantic challenge, 1 lakh cattle. What do we do? So when we interact, some of you can give me some suggestions on this. Essentially, I think we are getting excellent support from the state government. Honorable Chief Minister is totally supporting us on every single thing that we are doing. Citizens have been supporting us. And now, because of the enhanced expectations from the citizens, we have set our goals also higher. One of our goals is that 2nd October 2019 will be the 150th birth anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi. Entire nation is going to celebrate in a big way. Ahmedabad has been Gandhiji's karma bhumi, Sabarmati Ashram, and where he started, and he led us in the freedom movement. I personally think, and I would like some ideas from you during the interaction, that the best, the most fitting tribute to Gandhiji would be that by 2nd October 2019, Ahmedabad becomes the cleanest city of India. This is something which I am, in the coming days, I'm going to take it to various sections of society, to youngsters. Because all of you people sitting here, you want things to change. You are not ready to accept them the way they are. All of us have seen what better can be. So all of us want a better city for ourselves, a better country for ourselves, a better life for ourselves. With the support of all the young minds like you, and of course the thousands and lakhs of people in the city, we are going to work with a lot of commitment and dedication in the coming days. And I'd like to thank Vimal Bhai and UMC people who have given me this opportunity and called me for this interaction, and that ends my part. That's half an hour. So 50-50, baki aap ka samay. You can ask me anything about management, and if I don't know, I'll say that I don't know.
Hi, I was primarily curious about your time studying in America. Of the things that you learned there, how much do you think was most relevant to your time as a commissioner in Rajkot and now your time as a commissioner in Ahmedabad?
Yeah. So like, I did Rajkot first 2 years, and I still feel that that was the best part of my career so far. It's a small city of almost like 1.5 million people. And that city supported whatever we did like anything. It's a small city, so probably what happened won't travel to the world. But we could make a lot of improvement in that city. And then I moved to another assignment where I was heading the State Transport Corporation for 1 year. And then I went abroad for this policy analysis course, 1 year policy analysis, master's in public affairs. I think, yeah, there are limitations. I mean, the Americans also did ask us that, what can we teach you? I mean, you already have a lot of experience. But and they had limitations, frankly speaking, because, I mean, it was a 37 people cohort, and 30 of them were Americans. And let me tell you that when Indian minds go to America, if any one of you will go, you will find that our schooling and our basic education helps us to survive over the rest. So when it came to like quantitative skills and statistical issues or regressions or these hardcore things, then of course we had a very easy thing to go. But the Americans also are good in some things. They're very good in working as teams. So we learned from them how we can communicate in groups properly, try to collaborate. So those are some of the things that we are very good. Even in project planning, they take a lot of time in planning things, policy analysis, and policy communications. So for example, some of the things otherwise appear to be, I mean, very obvious. But if you go a little bit into deep, for example, this cave-in thing, earlier I would have just told my people, ki, go and repair them, and I don't want anything like this. But this time I did ask them that I want all the cave-ins on 10 parameters to be analyzed using the root cause analysis theory. And I would like to understand what is it where the shoe is pinching. And from that, probably we have come to an analysis that the lines bigger than 1200 millimeter, which are older than 30 years, we need to take on a prioritized rehabilitation using latest technologies that are available now. So some of the things that we read over there, of course, help us. But then, as you said, there are limitations to what a 40-year-old can read and understand. Yeah.
Okay, I'll come to that.
So I'll take that. Yeah, so that was a very difficult day for me. The first week, Monday, I started, and by Friday, they had given the strike call. So I was still hopeful that it's a hoax, it's a kind of a blank threat that they won't really go on strike. And I was also hopeful that no union would be able to impose a kind of a 100%, would be able to get 100% support. But Monday morning, I got the call that they have actually gone on strike, and out of 48 wards, the entire city is now divided into 7 zones and 48 wards. So in 4 wards, there was a different union, they didn't go on strike. But in the remaining 44, the impact was complete. Not a single worker turned up for work. But I had told them, okay, we'll manage the city without you. I reached out to the public. I told that this has been going for several years. So probably our city will be filthy for the next 1 or 2 months. But if we can successfully address this issue, then probably for the long run, we would have taken care of the problem. So first day, they didn't turn up for work. And in the night, we made alternate arrangements, whatever we could. We had been appealing to the people to give the garbage in the door-to-door garbage collection system. And in the night, we made some arrangements to clean up the city. So the city wasn't really looking bad. So they realized within 24 hours that our strike is probably, the system is not shaken by our strike, so we need to do something different. And that is when they made a mistake. So the next day, that's on Tuesday, they stopped the garbage collection vans and beat a few of the drivers and damaged few of the containers and emptied the garbage on the roads. That is when they broke the law. So we had anticipated that they will be doing this. So we had put in place more than 80 videographers who shot and got the evidence of the people who were doing this. So we lodged on the second day by the evening, we lodged police cases, FIRs with names and with CDs and documentary evidence of the people who are doing this. And then by 8:30 in the night, we sat down and we drafted suspension orders for some of the real antisocial elements. And the orders were carefully drafted. Parallelly, we had also moved. So we were working on multiple fronts. We had reached out to the public. We had reached out to the political wing. They were rock solid with us. We had informed the government that this is going to happen and we have to deal it with a no-nonsense approach. We had also approached the Honorable High Court because the High Court had been giving us several directions. So we approached the High Court by way of filing of a interim application in the ongoing matter, that when we are doing something, this is what we are facing. Because this is illegal. The strike call was illegal. It was, of course, immoral because there was no genuine demand, but it was illegal in the sense that the provisions under the Labor Act had not been followed. They had not given any advance notice or any intermediation, etc. So the High Court also, by Monday night, the High Court had issued notices, not ordering, but suggesting that you should not go on strike since the rains are there in public interest. But they didn't give a damn to Honorable High Court's suggestion also. So while drafting the suspension orders, we did it properly. And those suspension orders were drafted, and throughout the night, finally, they were kind of ready to be served the next day morning. And this news went out to them. And I got a call like 11:30 in the night that we would like to come and discuss with you. So I said, it's too late for me to discuss. It's my sleep time. So we can discuss tomorrow whatever you have to discuss. So they said, what time? I said, 10:30 office opens, you can come and discuss. They said, okay, we will discuss that. Then I said, it's one small request that before coming at 10:30, please clean up the city. And then only you come to me. So then next day morning at 7, they all resumed work. And we discussed, and we have a large heart. So we are very clear. we have made it clear. Today also I had a meeting with the unions. We are clear that genuine demands will be sensitive, but we will not give in to blackmail, and we will not tolerate indiscipline. Because such a big city or such a big system cannot be run if you can't enforce discipline, whether it be my employees or whether it be ordinary citizens.
Hello, sir?
Yeah.
Here.
Yeah.
I had two questions regarding the things you mentioned in your talk. One was when you were talking about tackling encroachment and the issue of homelessness in the city, you said that there was a provision of transient shelters along with the rehabilitation program. So yeah. Can you just elaborate a little as to what that is?
Okay, so earlier the slum rehabilitation has evolved in our country in several phases. So earlier the government authorities would just remove the slums without taking care of the housing needs of the poor people. In the second phase, it evolved to a slum rehabilitation wherein people at one place, housing would be created at place B, and after the housing would be created, they would be moved from A to B. The problem with this system was that their socioeconomic linkages, etc., would be disrupted. So now the model being adopted across the country, and this is also something that we could successfully do it at a large scale in Rajkot, and now it's a pan-country model under the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, where the preferred model for slum rehabilitation is in-situ rehabilitation. That wherever the slum is, because another problem with the earlier system was that people would go to place B and either rent out or sell off the place A or vice versa. They would continue to stay A and rent out or sell off the new houses given under place B. So now, whatever the people are staying at whichever place, they have to be rehabilitated at the same place. So the slum is removed and the new houses are constructed at the same place. And during the intervening period, they are given a rental assistance. So whosoever is the selected developer, they are supposed to give, as per the prescribed policy, rental assistance to the project affected families. I entirely agree that this is one of the major problems, that when our building permissions are being given, one is the problem that the required parking is probably not enough to the actual requirement. The another bigger problem is what you narrated, that the parking is shown or as per the approved map, but subsequently some unscrupulous elements, they will sell it off or construct or use it for some other purpose. So this was one of the aims in our recent encroachment removal drive. So something like 35,000 square meters is what has been removed in approved parking, whatever the construction was there. Essentially, the solution to this lies only in enforcement and regulation. But there would be an inertia, for obvious reasons, in implementing these things. So that is where we need to kind of put in place a system which pushes the system to get rid of the inertia and implement its job. That's what we have been doing essentially.
How would you leverage the 74th Amendment Act? How would you leverage as a commissioner?
I mean, I can't leverage the 74th Amendment as a commissioner, because the 74th Amendment Act provides for delegation of certain powers from the state government to the local bodies. In Gujarat, it's been, at least in terms of the responsibilities, more or less, as I talked in the beginning, almost everything that is supposed to be delegated has been delegated. So within the city, almost everything that is supposed to be done by government is being done by the municipal corporation. Yeah.
What approach you'd be taking in any change in the policy or modification in the policy for any project in the city which accounts for a larger societal change? What should be the approach, keeping voting politics?
I mean, fortunately for us, right now the state government and the central government both are extremely supportive. Central government interaction is very limited in terms of only few schemes in which they are just funding. There's hardly any administrative or any other control or political control being exercised by the central government. So all other controls are being exercised by the state government. So our interaction is maximum with the state government. And fortunately for us, the state government has been exceptionally supportive in every single thing that we are trying to do. In fact, going a step forward, when we initiated all this in Ahmedabad in like 16th, 17th July, Honorable Chief Minister directed all other cities in Gujarat to do whatever Ahmedabad was doing. So that shows the commitment of the state government also. Yeah, I can hear you. Fine, that's fine. Yeah.
And so you also spent some time in the US, almost a year. You must have felt a difference between the cities of India and the cities of the US, especially in terms of noise.
Yeah.
The noise pollution levels in our cities are quite high, and most of it comes from the vehicle, mostly the vehicles. So, what is your view or your opinion in how to tackle this public health issue?
So, like noise levels cannot be attributed solely to vehicles, but I would rather them attribute them to honking. For example, vehicles, the number of cars per capita in US is almost 800 cars per 1,000 people. In India, it's only 18 to 20. So the number of cars and automobiles in US is much more than in our country. But it would be very exceptional, I mean, for you to find somebody honking in US. It's kind of an emergency scenario. In India, I mean, it's a favorite pastime. So, some of the issues, I mean, nobody wears seat belts or helmets or issues of honking, and everybody seems to be in a rush. If you ask them kahan jana hai, to nahi kahin nahi, bas normal ghar hi jana hai. So those are issues related to citizen behavior, which can be altered by a mix of education and enforcement. On the enforcement side, if you use a vehicle, I'll be happy to tell you that as part of the Smart City project, we have installed ALVD, automatic red light detection systems, and these traffic cameras with ANPR, automatic number plate recognition system. So I now actually spend 2-3 hours in my command and control center, which is the best command and control center in the country today, where I can sit and I can see any vehicle on any crossroad, major crossroad in Ahmedabad, and the system is automatically picking up the numbers of the violators, and it is integrated with the Vahan software of the transport department, from where we fetch the name and address details, and then we generate the e-memo and print it, and then we give it to the police. And then they send it to you. So I don't know if somebody has received an e-challan here. So some of you, there are some complaints also that it should not have come to us. I was slightly behind or forward or whatever this. But now we have a technology solution, exactly same thing that the Americans are doing. So we hope that with passage of time, we'll be able to elicit greater commitment towards following of traffic laws, please.
Good evening, sir. I have two questions for you. What is the municipal corporation's take on seeking citizens' participation in managing the city? And how do we ensure that we exercise participatory planning in a city like Ahmedabad?
Beautiful, I think. Best question, I think. I have been, frankly speaking, as the system stands today, there is not much scope for individual citizens to collaborate with corporation, and that's not a good situation because a lot of people would be wanting to do something. So it's on the back of our mind that in the coming few months, we should institutionalize this system in which anybody wanting to do anything, and that can be a person just wanting to spend 2 hours in a week for cleaning the streets, or it can be a planner who wants to give some inputs in planning the system. So as a first step, we have created a Twitter handle called AMC Feedback, where you can give some feedback. We have created an email ID on which you can give some suggestions. Going forward, I agree that we'll have to further strengthen and institutionalize this system where individual citizens, right now, I mean, somebody writes to me and I very, with a lot of hope, I just say that, okay, we should meet this person, and people are coming. A lot of people want to be a part of this change. So like one person came to me and said, ki, we are making e-rickshaws. And I said, why don't you donate 5 e-rickshaws? And 5 people to run them without charging any ticket, who can ferry the people from the multi-level car park to the CG road. And that person gladly did it. I was pleasantly surprised. So, and individual citizens, yesterday I had a group of youngsters who wanted to do something on electric vehicles. Day before yesterday, I had somebody who wanted to do something on solid waste. So we are going to move towards a system in which we can at least say it's the first phase of a people's government, where people identify the problems that they are facing, people collaborate and find the solutions, and then come to us probably to seek either financial support or some statutory approvals, etc. So that's a good suggestion, and we'll be moving on that. Yeah. Got it, I think. It's a good suggestion. We can work on that. Yeah.
Considering the recent market price, is it economical?
So we will change it so that even if you park on the footpath, you'll get a challan. I agree. That has to be the solution. Footpaths should not be meant for parking of vehicles.
Yeah.
We have taken up this issue with the traffic police, and they have agreed that right now, because when enhanced enforcement on the roads has led to an unintended consequence of vehicles going on the footpaths. That cannot be an acceptable situation. I entirely agree with the sentiment. We are aware of it, and we have already taken up the matter with the traffic police that footpaths should not be used for parking of vehicles. Yeah, yeah.
So there are also very big issue of illegal advertising on the train. So they are using their hotel and they sent in many places for it.
How did you know that this issue is so close to my heart? Because yesterday I was moving in the city, and I actually saw 2 small posters being pasted on the Sidi Sayyid Nijali. And I just felt so bad about it. I called up my office, so my people reached there, they read the poster, got hold of the person, and I think 1 or 2 lakh rupees fine has been imposed on them.
We are working to remove the waste from the trees. right. So will it some like kind of laws or
So you are doing a fantastic work. I mean, we need citizens like you. You can please share, or you can even take pictures and send them to us on WhatsApp or something. So we get the details of these people who think that they can put their name and advertisement anywhere. And it's only by penalizing them in a manner that pinches. That's only how these people will change. Otherwise, they will paste and you will remove. And probably they are more than what you are. So the problem won't be solved. But you are doing an exceptional work. I really appreciate that. So I had forgotten to talk about the street dogs. So we have a system of sterilizing them, but the problems we face, that they're only one or two NGOs, and they have kind of either ganged up or whatever, so they are asking for exorbitant charges. So I think you have some good understanding of this issue. So if there are any other NGOs, we would like to invite them and do this work. Yeah. Entirely agree.
So do you have such plans that our administration is not person driven but system driven and it remains for a longer time? And we really thankful for that. So if that is
I entirely agree. One of the lessons from my Rajkot experience, which I discussed with Mr. Vyas also, that if you are doing just enforcement, then one day you just leave the place and things go back to where they were. So we are very mindful of it from day one. For example, CG Road, when the parking issue came, there were one option was ki we'll go and just be very strict with anybody who is doing parking in a haphazard manner or illegal parking, etc. But we identified that we have to find a sustainable systemic solution which outlasts us or any of the officers, etc. And we analyzed what were the parking rates on CG Road and what were the parking rates on the 500 meter away Navrangpura multi-level car park. I was surprised to know that if a shop owner or a manager or a salesman on CG Road were to park their four-wheeler car the entire day, they would end up paying some 30-32 rupees on CG Road. And if they were to park 500 meters away on the Navrangpura car park, they would have to pay a little bit more. Naturally, there was no incentive for a person to go away and park. So we addressed this issue immediately. We moved a proposal. We convinced our political body. And we move towards hourly charges. So now on CG Road,
you have to pay 20 rupees per hour. So if I'm a customer, I have to go for 1 hour, I can afford 20 rupees. But if I'm the shop owner, I want to park my car the entire day, I'll have to pay 250 rupees. It comes to something like 6,000, 7,000 per month versus 1,000 on the Navarangpura car park. So the Navarangpura car park facility constructed at a cost of 30, 35 crores was lying idle, not a single car being parked. Now it's being utilized today. Yeah, with some effort. There are ways, I mean the normal complaint numbers and all, but right now I don't know whether it's a good idea or a bad idea, but we are not going into citizen vigilantism and neighborhood reporting, but because there are other connotations of all that happening. Because then neighborhood fights spill over to our offices. So having said that, coming 2nd October next month, we'll be taking up the issue of source segregation in a very big way. And we are planning a slew of measures which includes some kind of a pricing control, incentive, disincentive structure to move citizens towards waste segregation and proper disposal of waste. Yeah.
Sir, as the Oda chairman and municipal commissioner both being you at the same time, what challenges do you expect in coming time and what kind of Ahmedabad we can foresee? New Ahmedabad.
I think since you brought the ODA into the picture, so last week I've also been appointed as chairman of the Ahmedabad Urban Development Authority, and I spent a couple of days in another office. And just to give you a flair, I mean, I'm not trying to glorify what we are trying to do, but there are 7 or 8 companies which I have to chair, and all of them are full-time jobs. For example, the Sabarmati Riverfront Development Corporation, that's another thing. The BRTS is a third thing. The AMTS is a fourth thing. And we have built a 600 crore super specialty hospital, which is waiting to be inaugurated by Honorable Prime Minister in 1 or 2 months. It's going to be the best public hospital in India. So that's another kind of thing. Bringing back to the issue that you have said, I think a coordinated planning between ODA and AMC can help solve several of our problems. Because in the very first meeting, I was told that around the ring road, 35,000 houses have already been constructed. Those are not within AMC limits, but anytime, 5 years, 10 years, they are going to come within the AMC limits. So we have to start thinking about how we'll be coordinating and providing or extending the municipal services to those areas. So a coordinated planning approach with ODA and AMC will probably help us iron out some of those issues. Yeah.
So as you said, you are chairing like 4 or 5 organizations, maybe that be Sabarmati Riverfront Development. So what do you think, like, can there be a new mechanism wherein a municipal commissioner at your level would be able to bifurcate his or her powers into different people, those who can chair such organization and make your work as an administrator easier?
Yeah, that's exactly what we are moving towards. So for example, now I have 8 deputy commissioners and we have already obtained a sanction for 4 more. So we'll be having 14 deputy commissioners. Today I was trying to discuss the assistant commissioners. So we have to create a supervisory system in a slightly different manner. And for example, yesterday night I issued an order when I was reviewing the BRTS work. The general manager who is heading that, when I asked that person why you are not being able to perform, why we are not being able to increase the ridership, quality of buses, etc. So the final thing that that person could come out with, because I am holding also the charge of shops and establishment and profession tax and vehicle tax. So yesterday night we issued an order relieving that person of all other responsibilities so that that person can now dedicate.
Can such provisions be directly involved into some policy so that a person who's handling a single major entity like Sabarmati River Development or or DA or AMC, only a single person, like the person if he's handling it, only he should get that office and not any other office which is...
No, there are, see, there are issues when you create SPV, these are special purpose vehicles, SPVs. So when the municipal corporation creates an this kind of an execution SPV, so the entire Sabarmati riverfront, all the expenditure is to be done by Ahmedabad corporation and all revenues are going to flow into the Ahmedabad municipal corporation. So then it's envisaged as an execution SPV. So I take your point that we need to have dedicated personnel and we are moving in that direction. Yeah.
One of the caps that you also wear is heading the City Managers Association of Gujarat, and the lessons that are being the pilots that you're doing in Ahmedabad, how can you what can City Managers Association do, and you being the head of that organization, what role can City Managers Association of Gujarat play in replicating the lessons from Ahmedabad to other cities?
I think that's a good question. We should be able to learn from each other's experience. I don't feel that only we are in a position to tell to everybody else, but I feel that we should also be listening to other people and benefiting from the experiences of other people. So that platform can be a good platform for that fruitful exchange. Last few questions maybe? Yeah.
I have a request here. I'm talking about the
AMC mobile app. I am also not sure if somebody can tell me how to find and identify people who are doing anything wrong, burning waste or disposing waste or throwing waste or littering. So that's a challenge coming forward. A city surveillance network, I think more than 2,000 cameras have been placed around the city. But right now, the work is in the last phase of putting the entire fiber network and connecting them to the control room if somebody gets caught in a one odd case. But essentially, it all boils down to the citizens themselves understanding. It's our city. We have to take care of our city. Yeah, please.
As part of the IAS cadre, do you think that we don't have a specialist urban cadre or managers who are only looking at cities with that perspective? Do you think as part of the training or as part of the larger field of thinking, what's your thinking? Should we have a specialist urban management cadre as part of the IAS training?
It can't be part of the IAS because the IAS is supposed to be a generalist service. But it can certainly be thought that urban managers are welcome to get into the IAS. Nobody stops urban managers from getting into the IAS. Let's be clear on that. Because everybody gets into the IAS. Engineers get into the IAS. I mean, I was as a software engineer with Infosys, doctors, vets, commerce graduates, MBAs, IIM fellows, everybody gets into the IAS. So let the IAS stay as it is, open to everybody. So the best of the urban planners who work hard and who also understand constitution, law, poverty alleviation programs, everything, they can come in. Having said that, I think there is a certain possibility of getting the urban managers to work with the urban bodies. That is to be the primary interest thing. Okay, how can we have urban managers collaborate with municipal corporations or development authorities or directly work with them? Or probably even join them on their roles. So maybe that's a good idea. So next time I recruit some of my senior people, we'll try to look for some of the capabilities. And if anybody over here is interested in joining the corporation, they can let us know. So we'll try to see how we can get their services.
Also, I mean, community-oriented and, you know, religious, like, they are not economically that cheaper, but if they kind of, they feel like it's their responsibility to stay there and kind of take care of it. So if, as a result, the monument is not kind of maintained, because they are unconsciously or consciously kind of not taking care of it anymore. So I mean, even if we try to kind of relocate them, kind of give them housing, they keep on coming because it's a huge
I mean, yeah, that's a big challenge, but we don't need to relocate people. So as I have already suggested, that our preferred policy of whatever housing improvement or is in situ. So we don't have to move people from one place to another because that's counterproductive. Yeah. So you let us know which places it will be viable. My bike, it's in a way our initiative, because they are just a vendor for us. So my bike can tomorrow go, some other vendor will come, but we are trying to ensure that a bike sharing system is in place in the city. I mean, it's a chicken and egg problem that a great non-motorized transport, dedicated bicycle lanes are not available, probably because of that reason people cannot use, and since or whenever there is an attempt made of introducing such systems, there aren't many users, so they don't find it financially viable. So we have to try and resolve this, and we are trying to create more dedicated bicycle lanes, etc. And on the housing issue, the one particular site where more than 1,300 families were living, that we have been able to, yesterday we have resolved, and we have decided that the original occupants whom we had given the houses, we are rehabilitating them by giving them other houses. But several of the people, they had just rented, so we are cancelling their allotments. And on the other schemes, the final solution will be that all the housing schemes which are 30, 40 years old and which are in a dilapidated state, they need to go for redevelopment. So now we expect very soon there will be a policy from the state government on redevelopment of existing housing colonies, public or private, and we should be able to move on that. Thank you so much. I think it's been a long and interesting interaction with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. It was a wonderful interactive session and a lot of bubbling questions from the youth of CEPT University. And I would like to mention here that the Faculty of Management at CEPT University is the department which looks at urban management. And that is how we came and met you that day to tell you what we do here in the urban management program. And precisely many of the things which you have told, we take up these issues in our studios and our students come out with proposals. And if we get a chance, we can come and talk to you later more in detail about how we can mainstream these urban managers into the municipal corporations. So it was a wonderful session, and on behalf of Faculty of Management and CEPT University, it was a privilege to have you here. Thank you so much, and we look forward to having a wonderful, beautiful city under your dynamic leadership. Thank you.